You are listening to a free version of the Majority Report with Sam Steeter. To support the show and get another 15 minutes of daily program, go to majority.fm, please.
Folks, did you know that your phone can be a powerful force for change? With Credo Mobile, it can, because Credo donates $150,000 every month to groups like Friends of the Earth, the ACLU, and Planned Parenthood. Switch to Credo Mobile, the carrier that stands for women's rights, the environment, social justice, and so much more. Learn more at credo.com/majority. That's credo.com/majority.
The Majority Report with Sam Steeter.
It is Tuesday, August 13th, 2019. My name is Sam Steeter. This is the five-time award-winning Majority Report. We are broadcasting live steps from the industrially ravaged Gowanus Canal in the heartland of America, downtown Brooklyn, USA. On the program today, former city planner, urban study teacher at Hunter College, author Samuel Stein, on capital city gentrification and the real estate state. Also on the program today, the House Judiciary Committee begins to investigate Jeffrey Epstein's death. And as Trump launches his war on legal immigration, polls show more and more Americans want to grant more legal status. Trump administration attacks immigration judges union, meanwhile, and more signs point to a Texas that's in play. New report shows that half of the distributed 70 billion opioid pills were handled by only 15% of pharmacies. And congrats, America! Bulletproof backpacks see a 300% spike in sales. Meanwhile, Trump finalizes his attack on the endangered species. Hong Kong protests continue unabated. An Ohio man found with 25 guns, 10,000 rounds of ammo after making threats against the feds. Lastly, the Catholic Church and Boy Scouts about to be slammed with over 100 sexual abuse suits. All this and more on today's program. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the show. It is Tuesday. Brendan is back with us. Jamie, of course, is here. Matt is, of course, here. And Michael continues his vacation unabated.
Hello.
We shall see. I mean, supposedly, what
he'll be back tonight with Brianna Joy Gray.
Right.
And
wow, that's super
Elaine
convenient.
Yu, so
I would put the chances of him being at home right now, lying in bed, pretty high.
He's gonna
or just hanging out.
He's gonna accidentally do his own live stream from his couch.
Yes, he's probably right now. Like, wait a second, I can get more Patreon content.
If he comes back chilled out, then that's super fine.
I've done some research. I got someone to for free look at an analysis of when my Patreon content plays the best, and it's actually at 12 noon, so I've got to do a live stream. Anyways.
Competition would start kicking in.
Tomorrow we'll go over that Progressive Voices video. So I just want to draw your attention to that last story that I mentioned. That on Wednesday in New York State, there will be hundreds, or at least 100, but probably close to 200 at least, lawsuits filed against institutions and individuals for sexual abuse that has occurred in New York State between the late 1940s and early 2000s. At the very least, we know of 100 cases, 75 against the Roman Catholic diocese across New York, the rest against the Boy Scouts of America and Rockefeller University. There are there's a law firm that's contemplating filing another 500 additional lawsuits. This is coming out as a function of the passage of the Child Victims Act. And it basically gave a one-year window to suspend the statute of limitations and allowed people who were children who were sexually abused to file lawsuits. At the time, in fact, I think it was just literally when we did this interview on April 11th, 2019, we were in Las Vegas for the Mass Torts Conference, where we spoke to a bunch of trial lawyers. And sometimes we speak to other advocates and whatnot. One of those advocates we spoke to was Bridie Farrell. And she was an Olympic figure skater, speed skater, excuse me. And she had, apparently it was a fairly well-publicized, was assaulted, sexually assaulted. By another figure skater. And she became an advocate to push for this Child Victims Act. When we sat down for the interview, and you can find this on YouTube, it's Sam Live from Las Vegas, Day 1, MR Live 411-19, I think, if you'd have to search for it. And she explains the whole dynamics here, but that was right, I think, on the day or the day before or day after Andrew Cuomo had signed this bill. And so check that out, just a follow-up. And the implications of these legislation, you know, stuff makes a huge difference. Makes a huge difference, this type of legislation, the type of activism that brings this stuff about. She'd been working on this for, I don't know, maybe a decade. The specific piece of legislation, and now you're going to have over 500 people, maybe more, who are going to, and in many instances, it may be about trying to recover money. In other instances, it may just be about trying to get some type of closure and hold people who have raped people, who have sexually assaulted people, hold them to account. And This concept of opening up the courtroom, in this instance, it was about statute of limitations that would have been unfairly limited. Not only with the statute of limitations, there was a one-year moratorium, but it also expanded from, like, if you were assaulted under the age, I think, of... New York at one point prior to this bill had one of the nation's most restrictive statutes of limitations. Survivors in the state had only till the age of 23 to file civil lawsuits. The average age that victims disclose their abuse is 52 from when they happen as children. And so now you have until the age of 55 to file civil claims. I mean, a lot of this sounds like so obvious, but it wasn't the case. And part of the reason was, frankly, the power, I think, of the church to limit this. And the law is a very, very powerful tool. In one of the interviews that we have, actually, over the course of our vacation, is about the law basically creating the market. But you see it in the case of every aspect of our society. I mean, it's a fairly obvious thing to say, but people lose sight of this stuff, I think, a lot. And how that law gets implemented and adjudicated, obviously a function of the courts. So let's take a look at let's turn to something else here for a moment. This is one of those stories that is this story is doing so much work for Fox and Friends. The opportunity for them to become pedantic in a way, theoretically, I mean, towards black people, but also as a way of all of them sort of saying, like, see, we're not racist. As long as black people behave the way that we want them to behave, we're good with that. And
poor people.
What's that?
And poor people.
Well, and then the other work it's doing for them is it's also showing that, like, it is a rare instance, right? Because you put something on TV, it by definition news, where you see poor people who actually exert, who show some type of actual morality and righteousness. And
or a sense of place.
Right. And a sense of place. And this is a perfect example of the lack of morality that poor people have, because this is the exception. The exception proves the rule in this instance. I mean, this is doing so much work.
Yeah, these are the special ones who deserve charity.
Right, exactly.
Deserving exactly. Poor.
And also, if you reach a certain bar, you deserve charity, but that's it, right? We can't have any type of comprehensive addressing of these problems. But let's listen to the clip first, and then we'll talk more about it. It's a picture of three kids, probably, my guess would be, ranging from like 5 to 7 to 8, maybe, who are in their three kids in their own prayer circle. They're wearing uniforms, school uniforms. Here we go.
And look at this photo of the siblings praying before the first day of school. Well, this is going viral, and you can understand why, because it's the story behind the photo that is truly incredible. The Harris family lost their apartment just a day before the picture was taken in Louisiana. Both parents also recently lost their jobs. Despite that, the family stays faithful and optimistic, saying, "We pray for everyone." A GoFundMe page is helping them get back on their feet. They lost their apartment, they lost their jobs, and their kids.
Another family we need to have on the show. Bless their hearts. They lost their jobs and their apartment, and they're still teaching their kids to pray.
Yep.
That's so sweet.
Puts life into perspective,
yes,
right?
Yes, go donate on their GoFundMe page. I know. Those precious kids are all in their school uniforms.
Well, you know what? Despite life circumstance, clearly they've parented kids with perspective.
I know.
And that's the takeaway.
Yeah.
Without a doubt.
To acknowledge God in all things.
Oh, my God.
Yeah. I am so blown away by this. It is like, bless their hearts. First off, I love the sort of the way they just like it's they just lost it. They lost their apartment. They lost their jobs. Like, they put it down.
It's a deus ex machina.
Exactly. It just sort of like it went away. That's the thing. That's the way it works with apartments and jobs. If you love something, let it go. If it comes back, it was yours. If it doesn't, it was never yours to begin with.
It's a natural process.
Right. Like, they don't put together that, like, they lost their jobs and both of them, and then had no money. And so now they're homeless, which they do not say those words. They're homeless. These kids are now homeless. The family's now homeless. Bless their hearts. We've got to have them on the TV show.
You know, she wanted to call them something other than kids, too.
What do you mean?
I just heard the offensive diminutives circling around in her head.
Oh, I think she thinks those children are precious because they're in their uniforms. And they're praying. And they understand that God's doing this for a reason for them. Now, God would never do it for a reason to me. Right? Because look at me. I'm on TV. I'm making millions of dollars. God wouldn't do that for me. But he's doing it for them because they need this.
In Milan Kundera's The Unbearable Lightness of Being, talks a lot about kitsch, which is the ideal that SHIT, just for YouTube, SHIT doesn't, it's the denial, SHIT is denied and everyone acts as though it did not exist.
And right. And that's what this is. And this is just sort of like, they, God has chosen them to deal, and it's going to make them stronger.
And it's precious, and they're in their little uniforms.
It's so precious, and they're in uniforms, and they're praying. And isn't that sweet? They're begging God so that they can have a home and probably food, because, of course, they... Now, to be fair, you know what's amazing is they don't even put up the freaking link to the GoFundMe page.
Yeah.
But that aside, the idea, they're so deserving of charity. Now, let's get back to our regularly scheduled programming where we condemn people for going on food stamps, where the notion that there would be any type of government support for housing is a complete sign of
socialism
well, and destruction.
Some of the undeserving poor might get housing.
Their loss of their jobs. Well, we shouldn't have any type of support for folks like that. No, this is their entire project is to not provide support for people like this. But now we have an opportunity to pick people out of the crowd and say that we have deemed you morally righteous because you wear a school uniform and you pray. Kids, probably maybe you go to a charter school or a parochial school. That's why they got the uniforms. We picked you out and we're going to deem you worthy of a GoFundMe. But there's nothing society could do. We can't even figure out why this machine, this act of nature made you lose your apartment.
God forbid we report on that.
Oh my gosh.
You know what I'm praying for? I hope that when these three little kids grow up, they gain class consciousness, overthrow the bourgeoisie, and put these three class enemies in the gulag.
Yeah, well, at that point, they'll be quite old, and they'll be tough to track down, but...
I have faith.
There you go. Fox and Friends doing overtime, also showing that they don't have any racial animus. We'll praise any children who've lost their homes and their parents are lost their jobs as long as they're praying. All right, we're going to take a quick break. Just a reminder, this program relies on your support. You can become a member at jointhemajorityreport.com. Also, don't forget to check out the AM Quickie. Going on vacation in 2 weeks. And for those of you who still want to get just at least the daily headlines, AM Quickie will be there. It's there in your audio feed. We only have it in the audio feed of the Majority Report. So subscribe to the Majority Report on iTunes. You don't have to listen to the show if that's not the way they usually consume it, the Majority Report, but... listen to the AM Quickie. It's 5 minutes, and you will get the headlines that you need to know of the day. All right, quick break. We'll be right back with Samuel Stein. We are back. Sam Seder on the Majority Report. On the phone, it's a pleasure to welcome to the program PhD candidate at the CUNY Graduate Center in Geography, a planning activist and author of the book Capital City, Gentrification, and the Real Estate State. Welcome to the program, Samuel Stein.
Thanks so much for having me on, Sam.
Capital City. little bit of a double entendre there in some respects, right? Because we're talking about, we're talking about Albany. So it's not really. I got confused for a second in terms of New York. But let's start with this notion. Will you explain to people just what urban planning is, who urban planners are?
Sure. I mean, urban planning has taken all sorts of different forms in different places and times. It's kind of something that's always been done as long as there have been cities. But it's been a profession for the last a little over 100 years in U.S. and in European and other cities. And urban planners are kind of tasked with sorting out urban space, making decisions about where things will be built in the future, about transportation and infrastructure systems, all the things that make cities run. And sometimes it's described in these kind of apolitical, technocratic terms where it's all about finding the best solution for everybody and making everything just simply more efficient. But the truth is it's always political, because any decision that urban planners make is going to benefit one group of people more than others, or sometimes at the expense of others. And so it's, I think, an intensely political process over how our cities are going to unfold over time, who's going to benefit from that, who's going to be able to live in them, and who will be displaced, how will people move around, where will they work? All those questions are really central to urban planning. Often it's done at the city level in the U.S., sometimes at the regional level, sometimes the state, and sometimes the federal. But it's really at that municipal level that a lot of the most important decisions around zoning and land use and other things are made.
And your book, at least in part, is briefly gives a history of how of the nature of the political forces that were basically tasking and defining what the results of the urban planning should bring about, right? And do you want to just briefly do that? And it takes us up to essentially to urban planning being a mechanism to really to commodify, I guess, overall else, real estate. But why don't you give some examples, just like maybe even the Napoleon example, think, of, you know, just so that people can get a notion, and then we'll take it through the manufacturing. So people get a notion of what were the incentives behind the political decisions that were basically provided the instructions to the urban planners.
Right. The Napoleon example that you mentioned is a famous one in urban history. Baron Haussmann was given really free rein to remake the city of Paris after a series of urban rebellions. And so that remaking took many forms, and it's very clearly visible in the city today. These wide boulevards that connect up in radial patterns, a kind of flat street wall where all the buildings match up with each other and have a not uniform but complementary design. All that stuff was planned. It didn't just happen as a result of the free market deciding that that's how it should be. But it wasn't just about making, you know, beautiful sight lines and architecture. It was also about defending property rights and defending the regime after this working class uprising had really threatened the power. And so one of the reasons why those avenues are so wide is that it's really hard to build up a barricade that will block it off and let people take control of it. And it's really easy to drive a military straight through it. So these decisions are not just about aesthetics. They're not just about efficiency. They're really about who rules and how. There's this question that I think we don't ask enough, but is really valuable, which is why exactly do we need urban planning in capitalist cities? If the kind of ideology of capitalism is that the market sorts things out most efficiently, then why isn't that the case in terms of urban development? Instead, we empower elements of the state to make these decisions to regulate private activity. And so there's all sorts of reasons why capitalism demands urban planning, and that demand has changed over time. So some of it is about setting up all the infrastructure that capitalism demands, the roads and bridges and sewers and water systems and electrical grids and internet and all that stuff. Is generally publicly provided and then managed, sometimes then sold off to private interests. But capital depends on the state to set it up in the first place. There's also what we call social reproduction, which is all the stuff that goes into enabling us to live another day and to have kids who will be the future of this society. Capitalism demands that the state take care of a lot of those demands, like education, so that we have an educated workforce, we have a public school system, food stamps to make sure that people can eat and go to work the next day. All that stuff capital demands that the state manages. And then there's these questions of land. So all this stuff happens on top of land, all this capitalist activity. And they look to the state to kind of manage how it's all going to go and to rationalize it between competing interests. And for a long time, those competing interests within the capitalist class were manufacturers on the one side, industry, and real estate on the other, the owners of land and buildings. And they both needed infrastructure. They both needed an educated workforce, but they had somewhat separate demands when it came to the particularities. So in the case of manufacturing, the factory owners and the like, they tended to want land to be cheaper rather than more expensive, because if they're buying land, they're doing so to build something on top of it. They don't want to lose a whole bunch of money in land. And they like housing to be cheap, too, because they want their workers to have this kind of low-cost housing so that they're not constantly demanding higher wages. On the other hand, they want the state to do as little as possible in terms of environmental regulation, because they want to be able to pollute and dump whatever they want into the water and air. Real estate.
I give you the Gowanus Canal, as it were.
Yes, right outside your studio, if I'm not mistaken.
Well, it's not too far. Steps.
You can smell it.
It's on a good day.
So real estate capital in general wants a lot of the opposite things as manufacturing capital. They want the price of land to go up after they've purchased it anyway. They want to make money off of the difference between what they bought land for and what they can sell it for. They want housing to be expensive because rents are the key to their income. And they might be okay with some forms of environmental regulation because it might make that land cleaner and nicer to live on and therefore of higher value and worthy of higher rents. So there's this kind of contradiction between what different elements of capital want, and they look to the state to sort it out. And the planners in the state then have to balance the interests of those competing capitalists with that of the rest of us, you know, workers, residents who have our own set of interests about what we want. And so then you got these kind of like participatory processes that brought in the public, but constrained what our choices were to make sure that capital got what it demanded. That's how it worked for a very long time in this country and in many others.
So just to be clear, so we had all these various competing interests, because we live in a capitalist society, obviously sort of the capital in its form of both real estate and in the form of manufacturing tended to win out. And it was also probably a function of the locality, right? Where, mm-hmm. where in some instances, manufacturing might be more powerful than real estate interests and
totally.
And vice versa. In New York, and I think you also cite Detroit at one point too, that we saw this change happen in the 70s where the scales tipped in one way.
Right. And I should say beforehand that, yes, the role of the capitalist state is to make sure that capital gets what it needs to keep growing and accumulating profit and all that stuff. But that doesn't mean that workers and residents didn't have victories through urban planning. You know, people organized to demand things that were completely the opposite of what either real estate or industrial capital wanted. And they could sometimes find an ally in one sector or the other in favor of a change. So, you know, residents could count on certain industrial capitalists and lobbying for rent control because all of them wanted lower rents. And maybe the opposite in terms of environmental movements historically. So it shook out in all different ways, but the role of the state was to ensure the capital was cool no matter what.
Now, maybe it's hard to sort of assess. I mean, it's got to be so almost like a situation by situation analysis. But from the perspective of, and I guess maybe the hard part is sort of defining this, but from the perspective of, let's say, the working class, from the perspective of the so-called middle class, what was better? Like, I mean, you know, and then I also want to ask, like, what would be better? Mm-hmm. But what was better? I mean, would you, if you wanted to be, if you were working class, middle class, I don't, maybe even if you were, you know, extremely wealthy, you might prefer a city that has more diversity and et cetera, et cetera. But what was better for those people in terms of who was dominant? And then let's talk just a little bit before we talk about that change in the 70s. Like, what would be better? Like, what, mm-hmm. you know, is there an objective standard out there as to, you know, in the absence of an oversized a power of a specific interest, what would a good city be?
Right. Well, in terms of what's better, you know, you don't want a situation where either industrial capital is all powerful and we're all coughing our way to the smokestacks, or where real estate capital is all powerful and nobody can pay the rent and we're commuting 2 hours to get to our jobs. Those are both bad situations. And honestly, the mix of industry and real estate wasn't so great for most people either, but it afforded certain political possibilities in terms of there being a split within the capitalist right. class at the urban scale. So it's not like there was this utopia before the 70s that we could all live in, but we did have a bit of more of a handle on our housing crisis, at least for significant stretches of that time. And in terms of what's a good city, I mean, that's subjective. That changes by, you know, different individuals, different groups, preferences. I think a lot of people have pretty strong feelings about the places that they love. You know, I'm a New Yorker. I love this city. I love the scale of the city. I love the density of the city. I love being able to get around on transit when the MTA isn't shut down at random hours. I love all that stuff, but I want to be able to enjoy it without, you know, losing most of my paycheck to my rent and without a whole kind of class of people making a ton of money off of changes to that built environment. So I think what a lot of us want is access to the places we love. And we want to be able to change them without worrying that making them better will somehow displace us. You know, there's a lot of people who would love to have better transit and better parks and bike lanes and all these other things. But they're afraid, quite rightly, that if those things are built out and there's no protections added for them, they're not going to be able to enjoy them. They will have suffered through the time when they didn't have those things. And then once they get them, the rent goes up and they can no longer afford to live there. And somebody who makes more money can enjoy all the benefits. So what we're looking for really is the ability to have all the things we want in our cities without the presence of those things equaling our displacement.
So in some ways we want to be able to invest in the community without and reap the benefits basically of that investment rather than provide it for essentially wealthier people, right? I mean, that's basically, we're talking about the problem of gentrification.
That's right. And it's reaping the benefits at the social level, not the individual level. You know, if you're a homeowner right now, you might like all these things because your property values will go up and then you sell your house and you make off like a bandit. But we're talking about the right to enjoy them in perpetuity without anyone getting richer or poorer off of the change.
All right. So maybe it's a good time to sort of define what gentrification is. I mean, in some respects, I think we just did, but, but more pointedly, what is gentrification and is it always bad. I mean, I guess if you are one of those homeowners and you can hang in there and all of a sudden, you know, a house you bought 20 years ago for $25,000 is now worth, I don't know, $750,000, you might be pretty happy. Although,
sure.
Unless you want to live there.
Yeah, that's the problem. If you want to live there and your wages aren't going up, but your home value assessment is, then the taxes that you pay on that home are going to go up tremendously and you might not be able to afford it. And we've seen people fall into foreclosure precisely because their investment became more valuable and they couldn't keep up with it. So, you know, gentrification as a word gets thrown around a lot. It's not always precisely defined. Part of that is the fault of whoever is imprecisely defining it. And part of it is that it's a kind of evolving and mutating force that has meant different things at different times and places. The definition that I give in my book is that gentrification is the process by which capital is reinvested in urban neighborhoods and poorer residents and their cultural products are displaced and replaced by richer people and their preferred aesthetics and amenities. So it's a process of reinvestment in space. And I also say that it's the third step in a very long process. And the first step is investment in a place, which, you know, often happens many, many decades before gentrification. So a place is invested in, it's built up, all the infrastructure goes in, the beautiful apartments and buildings and homes are built up.
Some of then that investment is private investment and some of it's city, social investment. Okay.
Right. It's public investment in infrastructure and transit and then private investment in buildings usually. So that investment happens. Then there's a period of disinvestment where capital kind of flows out of those places. And that can happen for all sorts of reasons. You have, you know, the rise of the suburbs in the middle of the 20th century, pulling a lot of capital that would have been in cities and sending it to suburbs. You have redlining and other federal policies which codified racist real estate practice into U.S. policy and made it so that a lot of central city neighborhoods that had African-American and immigrant populations would have a harder time getting loans. In some places, it was impossible to get loans. And so the built environment crumbles. And so those are spaces of disinvestment. Gentrification, then, is the return of capital to those places. So it's the third step. After investment and then disinvestment, you have a reinvestment in these places. But it does so in a predatory sort of way that doesn't benefit those who stuck it out during that period of disinvestment, but instead tends to displace them to other disinvested areas.
In some ways, it's sort of like a slow-moving disaster capitalism model, right? You come in, you see everything is now depleted, and you come in, you get everything 25 cents on the dollar, essentially. Mm-hmm. And then it gets built up, and then people get displaced, and then rinse, repeat. Right. I mean,
exactly. It's a process that kind of seesaws where capital moves out of some place and goes into another. And then poor people move from one place back to that other place. And it's not like, you know, switching back A, B. It happens in multiple places all over the world. But it's this mode of uneven development where nothing is ever stable. And it's very hard to settle and have roots and know that you'll be able to stay in this place that you're building up through your own, your work. You know, sometimes that's physical labor in building buildings and infrastructure and everything else. A lot of times it's kind of social labor, building up neighborhood institutions and PTAs and all that work that goes into making a place survive over time. You know, you're displaced from that product of your labor over many years.
So let's get back to this story of what happened in the 70s as manufacturing basically leaves New York and Detroit. And I guess I got Detroit on my mind just because I interviewed, and we're going to play this interview in a week or two, about the car business, essentially, the U.S. car industry, and how they made some decisions based upon their relationship with labor that basically took all of the, disinvested from Detroit, essentially, and in that area. But this happened in New York. Why did the manufacturing leave New York?
Well, there's a lot of reasons. There's kind of push and pull factors from different places. So a lot of manufacturers, industrial capitalists, are looking for somewhere else to move to that has cheaper labor and cheaper land. So New York has been for a very long time a union town, and it's also quite an expensive place to operate. And so first the immediate suburbs, then the U.S. South, then the global South become places that industrial capital can move to and take advantage of lax labor laws, lax environmental standards, and cheaper land costs. But it wasn't just the industrialists making this decision on their own. There was a lot of pushing out that was happening as well, rezoning industrial areas to be mixed use. And when you make that change, sure, an industrial operator can still be there, but you can get a lot more money off of changing that to a residential or commercial use than you can out of an industrial use if you're the owner of that land.
What drove that rezoning?
So some of it is an ideological commitment to commercial and residential uses being better than industrial. That industrial was the past and offices and luxury housing was the future. Some of it was wealthy landowners who would basically get experts to tell the city planners that the right thing to do would be to make that change. And then you have this kind of technical language about progress masking the interests of whoever owned the land. The Rockefellers, for example, were notorious for this sort of thing. So even though it had such a kind of massive impact on the city, we lost something like 500,000 industrial jobs between 1950 and 1990. This was something that city planners embraced as part of the progress of the city.
Interesting. And then, of course, there it creates this, well, it's not even creating a vacuum, right? I mean, it's immediately filled by real estate interests. Mm-hmm. And they become the dominant force. And this is really almost like the financialization of real estate, right? I mean, it mirrors the sort of the financialization that happens across the country in all sectors.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, I do think a vacuum is a good metaphor for it. So industrial capital is pushed out. And then there's this political vacuum where real estate capital can now be the main branch of powerful interests that are making demands on the city planners. We talked before about the internal conflict between industrialists, manufacturers, and real estate landlords and developers. Well, now that contradiction has been resolved in favor of the landlords and developers who can make claims on the state, who can make demands on the state to raise land and property rent values, to raise or to enable raising rents by getting rid of rent control, cutting back on public housing, et cetera. And so real estate fills that political vacuum as well as the economic vacuum. We see more and more of our economy organized around finance, insurance, and real estate. And then there's a spatial vacuum also where that industry used to be gets converted into spaces that are intensive for real estate purposes, like turning old manufacturing buildings into luxury housing, lofts, etc., or turning our ports into high-end commercial office space and all those kinds of changes that get sold to us as the public as renovating those spaces.
And that's basically where we're at now, right? I mean, the where, at least in the context of New York City, where everything has just been so, the real estate is so financialized now that it's almost like for a certain part of it, it's like almost like a bank, what do you call it? Safe deposit box, right? Like,
yeah.
Like these are just become, this is just literally where people park their money, and almost
right.
Literally.
We are
a couple blocks away from what I understand is going to be the tallest building in Brooklyn, I heard some rumors about it being 100 stories. I don't know if it's actually going to be 100 stories. It's going to be one apartment. This is what I understand. I may be wrong about this. One apartment per floor.
Wow.
That is going to cost something like, I don't know, $5 to $10 million per apartment. And it's on Flatbush Avenue across from the health department and next to Junior's. I don't understand.
I'd like to live across from Junior's. That part sounds pretty
good. I mean, living next to Junior's would be pretty good. You get all the cheesecake you want, but what's going on there?
Yeah. I mean, there's a huge amount of development that's not really thought of as somebody's permanent housing, but instead as somebody's investment. And so people, some of them are New Yorkers, some of them are from other states in the country, some of them are from other places in the world. It doesn't really matter. They buy these apartments for the purpose of selling them for more later on. So sometimes they are kind of like weekend apartments for an occasional visit to New York City. And maybe a person who doesn't know New York City doesn't know the difference between Flatbush Avenue and Park Avenue. And they buy this place and they'll visit and then they'll go back home to wherever that is. And then eventually they'll just sell it for more money.
I just don't understand. It's like tulips on some level, right? I mean, because if no one's ever going to live there, how can it have this kind of value? That's what I don't understand, is that there's just sort of this presumption that like, oh, there's going to be someone even richer than me who's going to come by and buy this thing. And they're going to even know just as little about what they're buying as I do.
Gonna pay. Somehow it's worked so far.
Yeah. I mean, but at one point, right? Doesn't the merry-go-round just like get to the end of the line? Like all of a sudden, wait a second, I'm seeing the same people come back around again.
Right.
And I mean, what happens then in this context? Mm-hmm. Like, what's the next iteration of this? Is it just like disinvestment? And then, you know, in 75 years, I go in and I get that $5 to $10 million apartment that's on the 85th floor and I can pick it up for a song and just redo it. I mean, well, how does this work?
That's one possibility. But, you know, people have been predicting that the New York City real estate market is going to tank, you know, every year for 25 years, and it hasn't really happened. We had a bit of a slump in 2008, but it didn't hit New York City and other places like it quite the way that it did a lot of much poorer places. And even within New York City, it was, you know, southeastern Queens that got hit really hard by the foreclosure crisis and not, you know, downtown Brooklyn.
I specifically remember looking at a heat map of foreclosures, and there was, as far as I could tell, not one on the island of Manhattan. And that in part was because you have these condo and co-op associations that basically, acted as almost as, you know, as a second round of bank loan officers saying like, wait a second, this doesn't work. But you saw it all around everywhere else. I mean, in New York real estate in 2008, if I remember correctly, I think there was like a 6-month time where you could go and get set $25 off your rent, and that was about it.
It was not a major crash that, you know, we could all live cheap for a while. You know, those that hit the worst were those who were foreclosed out of their homes, and then it's not like there was a ton of cheap housing that they could get into because the rest of the market was relatively untouched. So it's possible that this thing will get so overheated that it'll crumble and we'll have another round of disinvestment. It's probably not going to happen on its own. So, I mean, I think we need to have political intervention to cool these overly hot markets, because it doesn't trickle down to the rest of us. It doesn't benefit everybody. If those new luxury construction is only going to be as this vertical safe deposit model, then that's not going to have any social benefit for everybody else. And yet, as you're suggesting, it's all premised on the social value that the rest of us create by making these neighborhoods fun places to visit every so often on a weekend, or places that are worthy of investment. So we keep doing, you know, the work to keep up the city, and yet a relatively small number of people is buying up a lot of the new construction. So it's not a sustainable model at all.
Okay. So how do you make that? How do you create that dynamic where the people who live in a community enhance the school to a certain extent, but also create a small market, maybe clean up the park, or they're you know, creating a demand for a movie theater or whatever it is, a grocery store. How do you ensure that gentrification doesn't happen?
Mm-hmm.
Or can
well, you? Yeah, I think you can. I think the first step is recognizing that we have a problem, that the system as it is set up right now will produce more gentrification. And so simply kind of feeding the beast to hope that we can take some benefit from it is not going to keep working. And a lot of our current policies and plans are fed on the idea that we're going to make the real estate market even stronger, and then we're going to concede some benefit back from that. You know, we're going to build up those luxury apartments in poor neighborhoods, but then a certain percentage of it will be affordable. And that has all sorts of problems. The affordable stuff isn't affordable to the people who really need housing. There's not enough of it. But even then, we're making the real estate market stronger, which is really, in the end, going to come back and bite us because we won't be able to afford to live in our cities anymore. So we can't just keep feeding the beast and expecting it to turn around and hand us something back. So instead, I think much more aggressive politics, like we've been seeing a turn to in New York and in some other places, are the way to go. So rent control is really important. We just strengthened our rent stabilization and rent control system in New York State significantly. There's more work to do on that front. But the beauty of rent control is you can do all those things to make your community stronger. You can clean up the park and you can improve the schools and you can have that movie theater. And your landlord isn't able to just see that change around you and translate it into a rising rent. Right. They can only raise the rent based on a change to the property itself. And even that is constrained in terms of making sure that they don't do it for pure speculation. So rent control is essential. Rebuilding our public housing is crucial. We have public housing in New York City and in other places. It has a pretty awful history in terms of pulling money out of it and letting it fall apart in terms of segregation. It doesn't have to be that way. Public housing in a lot of places in the world is model housing, and it has been that in its early history in the U.S. as well. So reinvesting in public housing in a serious way and in climate-friendly housing. Taking more and more housing off of the private land market and putting it into non-speculative uses. So that could be public housing, but it could also be community land trusts and other forms like limited equity co-ops. Places where you get the housing for what it actually costs, and then you're not allowed to sell it for anything more than you bought it for.
Now, we should say we have examples of that as well in the city, right? I mean, there are, I'm aware of at least some co-ops where you can go in, you can buy, but you cannot sell for like a percentage greater than X, as it were.
Yeah.
And you need to, and you can only sell to people with an income limits of Y.
Right. A lot of the time you can only sell to someone who is in the income bracket you were in when you bought it for. So it becomes an economic opportunity for someone like you when you bought it, even if since then you've gotten a raise and now you make more money. Yeah. Those exist around New York City. They exist in a lot of places. There's a really wonderful book called Carving Out the Commons about the creation of those in Washington, D.C., and tenant movements to convert their rental properties into these kind of limited equity co-ops. So those models exist. Obviously, the real estate industry doesn't like it because they don't make any money off of it. But we need to turn housing into something other than this hyper-financialized commodity, or else no one's going to have a place to live in the long run.
And the idea is that you will get more of this social and community investment if everybody feels like they're going to get payback for it.
Yeah, and maybe payback isn't the right word. Like we're going to be able to benefit from it, enjoy
right,
it.
Right.
We're not going to get paid back from it. And that can be hard for people to wrestle with if they're used to the reason for making any improvement being an expectation that you'll get more when you sell out. But I think there will be a real investment in place on a personal and communal level if we can decouple it from the fear that it will lead to displacement. And that'll be the case in terms of greening our neighborhoods, right? There's a lot of green initiatives that are excellent in terms of climate change, but could very well raise property values and then displace residents. And so nobody is going to fight for those things if they think that it's going to push them out of their home. If, however, we can move housing towards a decommodified form, I think a lot of people would embrace those green initiatives, the very same ones that they might fear right now.
And this is stuff that has to be done by state and municipal policy, right? I mean, I as an individual can't say, like, I am going to do everything I can to stop gentrification by not buying my apartment in that neighborhood. I mean, or is that, I mean, it doesn't work that way, does it?
No, it's not. It's, you know, it's not just a collection of individual choices. It really is a structural situation. That said, you can make better and worse individual choices. And if you are a property owner, you can, you know, not vote in such a way that, you know, leads to your property values going up and up and up and other people's opportunities shrinking. You know, there are personal decisions to be made, but ultimately we need state action.
Right.
And we need collective action. And I think the only way to get state action is via collective action. And most of the time that's going to look like a tenant movement. A tenant movement which has been building up in this city and in this country and really around the world as housing becomes more and more of the global financial commodity du jour.
I just before we finish, I got to just touch on you. One of the chapters in your book basically gives the multi-generational story. It's almost like a mafia story in the way. It's like the Godfather trilogy of the Trump family. Trump's grandfather, Friedrich, was basically made his money by being a pimp. And I don't think you put it that way, but that's my turn. And his dad made it by just overt racism. And he made it by basically getting tax breaks and subsidies, essentially, Donald Trump. And we should say, you know, and his dad obviously being a guarantor on some of those early deals helped. But why, aside from like the obvious that Donald Trump, why tell that story?
Right. I mean, the obvious is important enough. We have a president who's a luxury real estate developer, and I'm trying to make the argument that real estate is this incredibly powerful force. Well, there's a good piece of evidence. But I also think that the family saga, that Friedrich, Fred, and Donald story that you told, is kind of emblematic of how people who make their money off of land have benefited from what urban planners and state actors have been up to for multiple generations. And so, Friedrich was a brothel developer, but he also was kind of capitalizing on the difference between land he could get before and after railroads were built. And so he was making a ton of money off of the change in the value after that investment was made, first in the Pacific Northwest and then in Queens. So it was an early form of real estate speculation. Then Fred is making money
now,
now,
when someone's engaging in that type of real estate speculation, they're bribing people, right? Right. Like this is how, like, either you tell me where the real estate, where the train is going to go and I buy it beforehand, or I buy it and then I pay you to put the train through it.
Right. I mean, that was pretty common practice in New York, especially when our train lines were private companies.
Right.
And all that stuff is documented in Robert Caro's really great book, The Power Broker. There were all sorts of people who worked the system to ensure that their land made money as those train routes were going out. And Friedrich is among them. He wasn't exactly the major player that some others were, but he's in there. And then his son makes money off of the federal government's interest in subsidizing white middle class homeownership. and also what they called urban renewal programs, which were tearing down low-income areas and building up new stuff on top of it. He was a really big player in that system in New York City. And then Donald gets in and is really like the model of a neoliberal developer. He's making money off of the fact that the city is interested in creating luxury spaces at a time when the city is getting poorer rather than richer. And he convinces them to give him tax breaks and rezonings, and public land and all this stuff. And all he does in return is build up luxury crap. So that's the history of the Trump family in three generations, each one changing its business model to match state policy around land planning and development.
Well, it's fascinating stuff. I would love to have you back on if you know anything about, you know, how folks were displaced to cities like Beacon and Poughkeepsie and all the way up to Hudson. On the Hudson River in New York State, and also if you got anything on the situationist sitting planning that they did with I don't know if you know anything about that, but they would let people roam on derives and then they would create emotional sectors in the city of Paris, but maybe that's for a later date. But in the meantime, Samuel Stein, the book is Capital City, Gentrification in the Real Estate Estate. Thank you so much for your time today. Really appreciate it.
Yeah, Sam, thanks for having me on the show.
All right, folks. Interesting stuff.
I saw Sam at the Close the Camps rally the other day.
Well, there
you
go.
Said hi to him.
Activist and scholar. I like that urban planning stuff. That was where I was almost going to go at one point in my academic career.
I took a class at that at NYU. It was sort of related to urban planning, but mainly how you turn slums in India into, you know, developed units. And the model they had seemed like it makes sense, but you give the people that are there units in the new giant building you're making. I don't know how well that's actually carried out in practice, but.
Well, just down the road here, I don't know if you ever seen The Battle for Brooklyn, the documentary that talks about how there was a lot of low-income housing that was basically taken for Barclays. And supposedly there was going to be a low-income housing that was going to replace it, which came, well,
how did it come?
I don't know if all of it was built. Some of it was, but it came so much later that there was no way for people to hang around. It's fascinating stuff. Folks, you can support interviews like the one you just heard by becoming a member of the Majority Report at jointhemajorityreport.com. And when you become a member, you not only support such interesting interviews, or tomorrow when we do deep exposés into videos by Progressive Voices, you also got extra content every day. And today in the fun half of the show, what did I do with my my sheet? Where did my sound sheet go? I may need another sound sheet, guys. We're going to be covering all sorts of different stories that apparently Ken Cuccinelli has figured out an answer for the question of, hey, do we need to take that plaque off the... a Statue of Liberty, where we welcome your poor and huddled masses, now that you've basically created rules that only allow wealthy people, presumably from non-so-called third world countries, to come in and qualify for legal immigration. He's got an answer for that.
Has anyone considered whether huddled masses are a national security threat, too? The huddling?
The masses.
They're doing something
with
that.
Too many
huddle.
Of them, man.
And meanwhile, we also have Ben Shapiro. Outraged. Outraged. That simply because conservatives have been hammering away at a perspective that one should take on immigrants, that the New York Times noted that and noted that the guy who shot up immigrants and killed 20 people explicitly saw them in that way. We will talk about that with Ben Shapiro. And also, Sonny Perdue said the quiet part loud in front of a bunch of farmers. He does not have the ability to shoot someone on Fifth Avenue and get support, apparently. That's only Donald Trump. We got that and more. So you can become a member and join us. Join themajorityreport.com. Also, justcoffee.coop, fair trade coffee, tea, or chocolate. Use the coupon code MAJORITY, get 10% off. And don't forget to listen to the AM Quickie. Jamie, the Antifada.
Oh, yeah. This week on the Antifada, my brain is so scrambled right now. What did we even do? That's right. I have an episode coming out tomorrow featuring Simone Norman. You may know her from that hilarious video that was going around where she was saying different things that are praxis according to mean girls who become public leftists and don't know anything. That was a super fun episode to record with her. We talked about the DSA convention, some of the things that got passed, open borders, and then in our bonus, we talk about the Praxis video. So check it out. Also, last Friday for patrons, we released the Vampire Castle, wherein we talk about vampires, not social justice warriors. Me and Leslie Lee III from Struggle Session, we talked about the hilarious TV show What We Do in the Shadows. So check it out.
Matt?
Yeah, for patrons of Literary Hangover, we did his essay, A Hanging, where we talk about his dad's career as an opium sort of bureaucrat in India under the Raj. And we also talk about, basically there's a hanging, as you can probably guess, and they tell a bunch of jokes after it. And the parallels between that and the way certain ICE officials in that I'm 10-15 group talked about floaters in the Rio Grande, a very similar sort of mindset going on there. And Orwell gave insight into that because he was, an imperial cop. So,
and assuming that Michael was able to hop his private jet tonight.
Yeah.
And
Brianna Joy Gray returns and Elaine Wu, we're going to be talking about China.
There you go. Where does he fly into? Teton Airport in is that airport in? No, the one in New Jersey. Teterboro. That's the one where all the private. Oh, is that where he was arrested, Epstein? Interesting. Well,
I don't think Michael's absence is related to Epstein's suicide over the weekend. Wow. I'll just say that. I'll say that on the record.
You don't think?
I do not think the two are related.
Okay, fair enough. Hmm. Interesting denial of a question that was not asked.
I mean, where were you over the weekend, DNC operative Sam Cedar?
Oh, I was with my kids. All right, quick break. Heading to the fun half.
You are in for it.
All right, folks, 646-257-3920. See you in the fun half.
Are you ready?
Who sent us this?
Anarchy. Alpha males are back. Back, 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 back. Boy is back. And the alpha males are back, back.
Just as delicious as you can imagine.
The alpha males are back, 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 boy, back. And the alpha males are back, 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 back.
Just want to degrade the white man.
Alpha males are back, back.
I take all of it in my throat.
Alpha males are back, 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 back.
Almost as what?
The alpha males are back, 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 back.
You are a madman.
And the alpha males are back, back.
I am a total cunt.
Can we bring back DJ Danarchy song, please?
Yeah, or a couple of them. Just put them in rotation.
DJ Danarchy.
Well, the problem with those is they're like 45 seconds long, so I don't know if they're enough of a break.
That's fucking nonsense.
Hey, fuck. Reminder.
I do not have Parkinson's.
And the alpha males are...
Psych. Fuck them. Fuck them.
Almost says what? What?
Have you tried doing an impression on a college campus?
I think that there's no reason why reasonable people across the divide can't all agree with this. Psych.
And the alpha males are back, 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 back. And the Africans are black, 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 black African. And the alpha males are back, 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 back. And the Africans are black, 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 black.
Out there, doesn't a little part of you think that America deserves to be taken over by jihadists? Keeping it 100.
Can't knock the hustle.
Come on!
Fuck them. Fuck them. Fuck them.
Things I do for the bigger game plan.
By the way, it's my birthday! Happy birthday to me, Jew boy!
I have a thought experiment for you.
And the alpha males are back, back. Africans are black, black. Alpha males are back, back. Africans are black.
Pay the price of blasphemy around here.
I am a total
pussy. Pussy, 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 pussy.
Did you know your phone can be a powerful force for change? With Credo Mobile, it can. Because Credo donates $150,000 every month to groups like Friends of the Earth, the ACLU, and Planned Parenthood. Switch to Credo Mobile, the carrier that stands for women's rights, the environment, social justice, and so much more. Learn more at credo.com/majority. That's credo, C-R-E-D-O.com/majority.